too limited and commutable, with two new admission being required by the staff to continue to access to the LGPS. The fund for this is satisfied that the objectives and governance structures of both entities align to the regulatory criteria to participate as community admission bodies. Section 2.8 notes that when the staff transfer pay, the current admission agreements will close and the exit debt will crystallise. Under the fund's termination policy, it is usual practice to seek immediate payment of the exit debt. However, the policy can be modified if all liabilities can be absorbed by another fund employer and securities provided to cover the debt. A request has been made to defer payment of the exit debt and to reallocate the assets and liabilities to the new Tory system. Officers are aware of the pension regulator's directive that pension schemes should avoid actions which hamper the growth of an employer, but I am mindful of the responsibility to protect the solvency of the fund. Advice was sought from Mercer as to the covenant strength of Tory 62 and the risk of rolling over the debt, with the outcome of the review presenting Tory 62 as a strong, cash-rich organisation. The conclusion reached was that in order to repay the debt, a legal transfer agreement and adequate security would be required. Section 8 raises awareness that the admission application process is resource intensive and the pensions admin strategy provides an administration charge for processing new admission applications. It is recommended that pension committee approve in principle the applications from new Tory 62 Limited Mutual with admission to Merseyside Pension Fund from the 1st of December 2018 and delegate the completion of the detailed terms of the pension transfer agreement, including the statutory guarantees, to the head of pension administration, which is me, and to the Board of Solicitor. However, as the exempt schedule provides the financial details with regard to the cost of admission and level of indemnities, if deemed necessary, you may wish to defer considering the recommendation until the
exam
part of the meeting.
Yeah. Anita?
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to ask the question, was there any way of avoiding crystallisation of the pension?
No, once the transfer takes place of all the active members from Helena and from the mutual homes, there's no active membership and regulation 64 prescribes that once the last active member leaves an employer, a crystallisation event occurs and we need to obtain new rates and adjustment certificate from the action. So we're compelled to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for that report. There are two recommendations and subject to any questions that may be asked in the exempt agenda items. Are we happy to note and approve the two recommendations?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, agenda item 13 again from the Govt.
Where we've got the now statute board, could you just Or somebody explain to me what are the conditions that trigger that situation, please?
Once the debt has been notified to the beneficiaries, if we didn't recover within 6 years, the debt becomes statute barred.
Can I ask a supplementary, please? It is a relatively small amount of money, but it's, you know, obviously money that's been written off from pension funds. Have we learnt any lessons from any of this in terms of reacting to things quickly?
We do have a mortality screening service that we're just in the midst of the looking at the contractors and doing it as part of the LGPS framework, so we are acting more quickly, and also we have NFI now. Some of these debts go back about 10 years ago, so we're more proactive with the NFI service now as well.
Okay, thank you everyone, and thanks for that question, Anita. So there are some exempt agenda items related to that, but other than that, we're happy to note the report and that the sum of £113,071.36 is approved for the write-off. John?
It might be better answered perhaps in closed agenda, but with reference, I appreciate we're talking about things that happened in the past, and
yes.
I think Councillor Leech's question is a very helpful one.
Yeah.
6 years is a long time.
Yeah.
There's a reason why I set it 6 years, to give people an opportunity to get what they're owed, so people don't rest on their rights and you sit on your hands, or then that's your fault. But we are looking to talk about something that happened in the past. With regards to a mortality unit, and this might be better answered perhaps in a private agenda, would we be looking to screen information via any credit reference agencies and look at, because not everyone will live within rural borough, for example, so we might not get a notification from the council tax department. And we need to be quite robust, because we are talking about members' funds here. Now, it is quite a small quantum, but if a member were to find out that a large amount of money had been written off because we haven't acted on it for 6 or more years, I think it would undermine their confidence in the scheme.
It's a point on that. Can I suggest then that we just conclude this agenda item in the exempt agenda?
Sure.
Yeah,
happy
with that. Right, and then agenda item 14, again, we're being asked to write off money. This relates to attention to tenants, rent arrears, and again, I'll ask Donna, you're talking us through. Thank you, Donna.
Thank you, Chair. The purpose of this report is to request that members agree to the write off of £92,246. Unrecoverable rent arrears from the fund's property portfolio. To just put that into a bit of the context, because I do appreciate the annual property rental income since 2017-18 was £26.8 million. As members will be aware, CBRE are managing agents for the fund's property portfolio, and amongst other functions, they have responsibility for the collection of rent and the management of arrears. On an annual basis, they produce a report of uncollectible arrears, which is attached as an appendix to this report and can be found in the example of that. CBRE has protocols in place to manage tenants who are experiencing cash flow and other financial difficulties and seek to support them in working through situations where it's justified. As illustrated within the appendix, there will be instances where tenants enter administration and rent and related property costs are unrecoverable. The recommendation is in section 13 and it asks that pension committee approves the write-off of uncollectible rental income detailed within the consent report. If anybody has any questions on the detail, I'm happy to answer those in the private part of the meeting. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, I'm good. I'm happy to take questions, but I think we conclude this agenda writing in the John?
Sure, I have no problem with that, but just because we're being webcast, I think it's worthwhile saying that even though members might have concerns with the previous agenda item, having served on the committee for 6 or more years, 7, maybe 8, I've lost track of the amount of time. I have every confidence that the fund and its officers have executed their responsibilities as diligently as possible. And as percentages, less than 0.00. unfortunately, when you're in a commercial enterprise, which being a landlord you are, these are one of the risks that you take. And I think the management of that risk is excellent, such that it represents such a small percentage of rental income.
John, I think that's a point well made. Appreciate it. Right, so we'll continue any discussions on that agenda item in the exam topic of the meeting. We do have agenda item 15, is working part in minutes, pages 125 to 130. And we'll ask to put in note those minutes, although again, some of the discussion points are exempt items. But otherwise, I'm happy to note those minutes. Okay, so we come to the point of the meeting where there are exempt items to be discussed. On that basis, under Section 100A4 of the Local Government Act 1972,